Let's go or no?
Yeah, let's start. Let's start. Let us start. So, do you have questions today?
Did you turn in the Lucas? Did you turn in the homework? Yeah.
This no. The one which you were.
The one I want to talk about.
The one.
This is mine.
The one. Something old. Yeah. No, you didn't. What is this?
Oh, that's the paper from the class.
My papers are. Mine is opposite.
Okay, so Lucas, you remember last time? It turns out that you are one homework short, that you are delayed. Are you ready with it today or not yet?
No.
You don't. Okay. What can you do? You can, of course, kick him out, but it would be unkind.
Well, I had a couple of questions.
Sure.
I was watching the recording of the lecture that I missed, and one thing that we were talking about the center of a group. So those are it's a subgroup.
Mm-hmm.
Well, first of all, it's a set of elements that that commute.
Yeah.
Even though it's not necessarily an abelian group, and you were proving why it was a subgroup, and first you showed that. I don't remember.
Your story. Whenever you have a subset.
Oh, you showed the in. Well, you said GH equals HG implies HG inverse equals G inverse H, just showing that G inverse is there or something like that, or. We're just showing that.
I don't remember.
Showing the inverse
is showing. But if we're discussing center, well, okay. First of all, there is this general formula, which I hope you understand by now. The GH inverse, you have to write as H inverse G inverse.
When you don't know commutivity, yep.
Yeah, and because it works no matter whether it's commutative or not.
Right.
And the reason is, of course, that if you multiply these two quantities, result is identity.
Because you can use associative property.
Because you can use associative property, exactly. And if you do it on the other side, it'll be the same story. Okay, so that's. Now, as far as center is concerned, the scheme of proof is not very different from any situation when we have a subset in a group.
Mm.
We have a subset in a group, what we have to check? Closed under multiplication.
Right.
And under taking inverses. That's it.
It's the second part that I just couldn't quite reproduce it.
So closed under multiplication. So for center, once again, what is definition? Consists of all g and g such that g h is equal to h g for all h and g, no matter which h. So it's elements which think that they're in abelian group. They don't know that they're not in abelian group. Of course, in abelian group, center coincides with all group. Every element is going to be the center. But generally speaking, it's not the case. So, interesting examples which we saw with you, of course, identity is always in the center because it commutes with everything by property of identity. But, so we saw with you examples when center is just identity. Say, in S3, it's only identity which commutes with everything. If you consider all permutations on set of size 3, and the same story goes with any SN. Any SN starting with n equal to 3, the center of a set will be just identity.
Starting with n equal to 3?
Yeah, because you see, S2 is too small. S2 has just two elements. It's abelian group.
I thought you said S4, you could.
Different things. Different things. What I was talking about is alternating group. I said that A5 and larger would be simple groups. So there are different things which happen at different times. But how large is S2? How many permutations of two elements you have?
One, two.
Two. That's it. So, and of course, group of size 2 is too small to be non-abelian, right? It's just Z2.
Mm-hmm.
But for 3 and for larger sizes, center will be just identity. It's rather easy to figure out. The center will be so.
permutation which commute with any other permutation will be identical. On the other hand, we saw another example. Say, you remember when we were looking at permutations of square only,
mm-hmm.
of square as a rigid thing. It turns out that we have central two elements, identity and another element, negative one, was also there.
Which
rotation 180 degrees. Rotation, whatever.
Oh.
Central symmetry relative to the point. Well.
Yeah, it was, wasn't that the one where you had the dot in the middle of the square?
Well, you have a square and you take the center of it, and then this point goes to this point goes to this point.
Central symmetry.
Okay.
Because it's in vector terms, it's like multiplication by negative one. If you put coordinates here, then every vector is just multiplied by negative one.
Okay.
So centers can be different. They can be larger, can be smaller, can be all group, if it's all group, etc. So to show that it's a subgroup, what you have to check? That if you have two elements in the center, that they commute with everything. But that's easy. It's consequence of associativity again. If you want to show that this is in the center, you redistribute brackets like this.
Right. You move the
then you move it because now this was central element, so you can take it through, right?
Yeah.
And now you can again redistribute brackets again like this.
Yeah.
You can take G1 through, and then again you can redistribute brackets like this, and
right.
that shows that it's central. Now what about inverse?
Yeah.
If GH is equal to HG, then multiply this by G inverse on this side and by G inverse on this.
Wait, what? Why did you put it on the left on one side and the right on the other side?
Because I want to get rid of this G and of this G.
For some reason,
if you multiply by G inverse on both sides, this thing.
So it doesn't matter where you put the...
I thought you had to multiply
the left. No. Of course, you have to multiply both sides by the same. It's not like I'm multiplying this by this and this by this. Then I will spoil the quality.
But we don't know if everything's commutative yet, do we?
We don't.
So I thought
but
you had to multiply the left
side. Nevertheless, what will be this product?
HG inverse.
This and this will cancel out.
Yeah.
It will be HG inverse, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now do the same to the left side. You don't know commutativity, but you know that... If left side is equal to right side, the same operation will give you the same, right? Here you will have G inverse. So you will have this is equal to this.
Wait, did you multiply both sides
by
G inverse twice?
By 2G, of course.
Oh, okay.
I cannot multiply one side on the left, other side on the right.
Oh, okay, okay.
I don't know commutativity.
Okay.
I cannot do it because then I'll spoil the equality. But by the same things, I can. And what I multiply by G inverse twice. On the left, on the right, on the left, on the right.
I got you.
Okay, and that's it. That's it. Okay, so that's as far as center is concerned. Anything else?
Yeah, that triangle with...
Which triangle?
The factor group.
The factor group.
It has a group, the factor group, and then it has this...
So we have G, we have G over kernel. This one?
Yeah. Is there any way we could do a numerical example of what that would look like?
Numerical example, we don't have numbers here, but...
Couldn't we think up some groups?
G, okay. Here we have projection. But we can try to do something on particular example. Okay, now, in general, so that's the general scheme. So our only interesting example with which we can play is S3. In S3, so let me again write what is S3. Right? S3, it is generated by these two elements, A and B. A cube with B squared is identity, right? And B, A, B inverse are the same as B is A squared. Or maybe we were writing it like this or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This group has a normal subgroup. This normal subgroup is one which is generated by A. Why it is normal? Well, of course, if you conjugate any element by A or power of A, it will stay there because... So the only thing to check is what will happen if you conjugate by B.
And when you conjugate by B, it will be BAB inverse will be A squared, just this one. And B, A squared B inverse is A.
So this is a normal group. So you can make this construction with the help of this normal subgroup.
That's
BAB
inverse?
BAB inverse.
BAB.
You're conjugating by B.
Okay.
You remember what is definition of normal?
Okay.
That you have a GH, G inverse is equal to H. You're conjugating by B.
So you can, if you want, we can make this construction in this case.
So just let's repeat. So what will be a normal subgroup? So I have one class. It is this subgroup. And another class will be B by this subgroup. And that will be it, right? Because we have six elements. Here I have three elements, here I have three elements. That's all group. So I have just two classes, right? Ebony, what's wrong?
Keep going. I'm a little confused, but I'll figure it out.
Okay, we're talking about group S3.
Mm-hmm.
It has six elements.
Oh, it does? S3 has six elements? Because the set of permutations
of three elements.
Of three elements.
Is three factorial.
Okay. Okay. So
six elements.
The three elements are A, B, and E, right?
Three elements are E, A, A squared.
Mm-hmm.
That's this subgroup generated by A. And this is coset, left coset of this.
Oh, shoot. And that's a B.
This is element B, right? So that's different elements, right? These three and these three don't overlap, so all group is exhausted. That's it. So now, how I multiply these classes? Of course, this class multiplied by itself is itself, right? So it works like identity. This by this will be, say, A by B, A. Is B A? How so? Because, as we discussed, this one and this one are the same sets, right? It's a normal subgroup. So left cosets and right cosets are the same. That's the property of normal subgroup. And of course, for this group, it's true, right? Because these three elements are 6 minus 3, right? But it's those elements of S3 which don't belong to this subgroup. And there is just three of them, so it doesn't matter. These three, it will be the same. It's three other elements. You understand what I'm trying to say? Okay, how I can write as 3? I can write it as E, A squared, B, B, A, B, A squared. And I exhausted because I have six different elements. That's it. But of course, I can write this as B, A, B, A squared, B. It's the same six elements. So I don't have any choice. These three elements and these three elements must be the same. Because altogether it's six. I don't have room to squeeze more elements. And so, of course, then you have B, and now when multiplied by A, you will get this. Okay, and what will be BA? Multiply BA. Again, this B can go through because it's normal subgroup. So I have B squared, which is identity by A. So it's just B. So you have Z2 as a factor group. Which is also clear. Why? Because original group was size 6. Normal subgroup size 3, when you factor it out, resulting subgroup has, resulting group is just, has size 6 divided by 3. Right? It's always the case.
Z2, I totally get that, 0, 1, and 2, right?
Z2 is 0, 1, 2 is 0.
Oh. How are we talking about Z2 right now?
Okay, if you have this situation, then size of factor group is clearly the size of the group Z2. divided by size of the subgroup.
Why? How we're creating these groups? Out of classes of, say, of left cosets. Each left coset has the same size, right, as identity coset. This is identity coset. H is identity coset. So all these cosets are of the same size. So how many cosets you have? Size of G divided by size of H. If you have size of group is 10 and each coset is say size 2, then how many cosets you have? 5. Yeah? 5 cosets each contain 2 altogether, 10 elements. So you always have this. So in our case, this group has size 6, this group has size 3. 6 divided by 3, I think, is 2. And what is the group of size 2? Z2. That's it. Consists just of two elements. Identity and another element, and then square of this element must be identity. And I don't understand what's happening with you now. So is it a good numerical example? I don't know.
I want...
What?
I get that part.
Hmm?
I get this part over here. I think I'm just a little confused. Over
this
here.
About this one?
Yeah, about here, the multiplication. Because we have BA, B inverse.
Do you remember this equality? BA is equal to A squared B?
Yeah, okay.
So if you multiply by B inverse of both sides, what you will get? BA, B inverse is equal to A squared. Because here it will be B by B inverse.
Okay.
It's
okay.
The same.
Okay, I see.
You say. You see, with groups, you are acting like with ordinary numbers. Just remember, it's not commutative.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to remember on which side to do it.
Which side? Okay.
And that's it. But otherwise, it's the same.
Okay. And that's how you. Okay.
That's how I wrote this one.
Mm-hmm.
Now this one. Well, say if you square it, then B and B inverse will come together and cancel out. You will get square of this is this. It's true for any elements. If you have G, H, G inverse, and you raise it into power K, it is always G, H in power K, G inverse.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you multiply it, G and G inverse will come together, cancel.
Mm-hmm.
So square of this is this, but square of this is this, because A squared is A in power 4, right? But A cube is identity. So A in power 4 is A.
So that's A squared in the middle.
Here it's A squared.
Yeah.
So when I conjugate this group by B, identity will go to identity, A will go to A squared, and squared will go to A.
Okay.
So that's why it's a normal subgroup. Okay? That's why it's a normal subgroup.
Isn't there some way that there could be numbers here?
Which numbers? Which numbers do you want? We're dealing with group.
Couldn't
okay, I can give you numbers if you want. Take all integers. They constitute a group relative to addition, right?
Sure.
Take all integers divisible by 7.
Okay.
They also constitute a group relative to addition. Because if you add two numbers which are divisible by 7, result is divisible by 7, right?
Okay.
What do you think will be factor group if I take... Integers are commutative group, right? Addition is commutative in integers. So any... Are you there?
I'm good, I got it.
Okay.
It took a while.
Okay, now, in abelian group, any subgroup is normal. Because in abelian group, G, H, G inverse is H, if group is abelian. Right? Because everything commutes. So every subgroup in abelian case is abelian. So you are looking at this numerical example if you want. Z and normal subgroup 7 times Z. What will be factor group? What do you think if we factor out from Z 7 Z? Any guesses? How many cosets I will have?
7.
Hmm?
Seven?
Seven, of course. One is just this. Then 1 plus 7z, right? 2 plus 7z. 3 and all the way up to 6 plus 7z. If I add 7 to 7z, it's the same as 7z. So 7 courses. So size of the factor group will be 7. So what kind of a group it will be? What do you think? If I have a group of size 7. What group? What can you say about a group of size 7? Can you say anything?
It's
a subgroup that's...
Can it have a subgroup? A group of size 7? Can it have a proper subgroup? What do we know about sizes of subgroups relative to size of a group?
They have to divide.
Yes, that's the divide. So what divides 7?
1.
Seven.
E.
It's not 7. Subgroup. 1, right? So it doesn't have proper subgroups.
Okay.
Right? So what can you say about a group which doesn't have proper subgroups? And if it has size 7, that's the case. So what can you say about a group of size 7? What kind of a group it is? We learned some terminology. What is the group? Starts with C. What is it? I forgot. You showed me something last night. So it starts with C. Starts with C. What will be after that? C and then. Of course, we learned which starts with C. We learned some important word. Yeah, which starts with C.
Does it have an E next?
No, it has
next. Cyclic?
Cyclic, yeah. It will be a cyclic group. Very good. Okay, are you going to learn this material or not?
Yeah.
Because test will come, you know, in no time.
No.
Okay. Was it a numerical example?
Yeah, was that this?
Well, you can think about this in the following fashion. Consider mapping from Z to Z7.